Hello and welcome to Italy for the last race of the International Formula 3000 series. Last time out at Spa, Justin Wilson clinched the title, but the new champion says he still has plenty to race for here at Monza.
I still like to win the race, and that's what people remember at the end of the season, is the last race, so that would be very good. And there's also the chance of beating Montoya's record for the most points. I'm equal with him at the minute, and it'd be nice to get one, or maybe it would be perfect to get 10 more points than that, but just to beat that record would be fantastic.
Well, you can see how Justin gets on very shortly. His other achievement this year, along with all the lads at Nordic Racing, is to break the dominance of Supernova, traditionally the best team in Formula 3000. We've been along to their base in Norfolk and found them determined to bounce back.
Supernova Racing, how can I help?
David, good to see you. Yeah.
David Sears is one of the most respected operators outside Formula One, not just for his team's achievements, but also for nurturing the talents of many of today's top drivers, like Juan Pablo Montoya, a former F3000 and Champ Car champion. The secret of success is simple. Everything must meet the highest standards.
When the cars come back out of the trucks, they're stripped down completely into various components, and the bodywork's sent away for repainting every race so that it looks tip-top. Gearboxes are completely rebuilt, the dampers are completely rebuilt, and the engines are rebuilt if necessary. So it's a bit like a Meccano kit. It's literally taken apart, put back together again. Sure. For every race. When the cars come back from a race or a test, all the information we've recorded is analysed, and then we play with shock absorbers and different settings and setups through the computers, because realistically, you're only out on the track probably for about 20% of the year, and the rest of the time when you're home base, you've got to really come up with new setups and systems and things for the cars.
The trophies prove they usually get it right, so being bettered this year by Nordic's been hard to take.
There's only one winner of a championship. We've won three times, we've been second three times, so being second again is tough, because we're all here to win. I mean, that's why the team works so well. They are all winners in their own right.
Well, for the final race in Italy, there is some good news for Sears. His driver Mark Webber automatically claims the championship runner-up slot. Rival Thomas Enger won't be racing, having signed for F1 team Prost. So there's a new man at Nordic, and he's brought his mum along. Another Czech, Yaroslav Yanis, partners Justin Wilson this time. Some introduction for the new boy. Just seconds before qualifying, Monza was hit by a vicious storm. This would be the most bizarre session of the season. Many switched to rain tyres, but others were already lined up in the pit lane and ready to go out. They had no option but to venture forward on slicks. Predictably, it was absolute chaos. In driving winds and with the track littered with leaves and debris, few could keep it together. After only 5 minutes, the organisers decided enough was enough. Trees, cars, all sorts had to be cleared off the circuit. Full wet settings with lots of downforce were now the order of the day, though most of the drivers didn't seem too keen to head back into the deluge. Not the ideal start to your F3000 career. After assessing the state of the track, the race controllers amazingly decided to restart the session. The rain was heavier and the sky darker. Only the bravest went out into the storm. Thankfully, the drivers were soon put out of their misery. The red flags waved for a second time, qualifying abandoned. Race day dawned warm and sunny, and the FIA had a cunning plan. A special 20-minute session was to be run right before the race to sort out starting positions. Immediately on the pace, Italian Giorgio Pantano for Astromega. Hot on his heels was Mark Webber, keen to make an impression after three disastrous races. Quicker though than both of those, our newly crowned champion, Justin Wilson. It wasn't hard to see why, the Yorkshireman fully committed on this super fast track. A course, the new format presented some big problems. With only 20 minutes between the session and the race, accidents like Antonio Garcia's made it a frantic day for the mechanics. Walking the fine line perfectly, though, was Antonio Pizzonia. His judgment spot on, snatching pole from Wilson by just 0.03 seconds.
Well done, pole position. It's been a very strange day, hasn't it, with qualifying on the same day as the race?
Yeah, I think only 20-minute session is a little bit different, but we have to push from the beginning, and I think the team did a great job, and now we have only 2 minutes to work on the car and go to the race. And it's quite different, but I think we're going to be ready.
And while the teams get busy on those cars, we'll find out how the Porsches got on with Simon Taylor.
With Super Cup leader Jörg Bergmeister on pole, Marco Werner had a lot to do today to keep his title hopes alive. But closest to Bergmeister on the grid were Philipp Peter, Timo Bernhard and Sascha Maassen. But it was in the middle of the grid that mayhem was unleashed. Alessandro Zampedri tapped Bruno Eichmann, who catapulted into the barriers, taking Fabio Bambini with him and then bouncing back onto the track. All the cars behind were brought to a standstill, but they were all able to squeeze through with only minor dents and scratches, while Fabio Bambini walked away unhurt after an extremely brief taste of Porsche racing. But the first lap carnage hadn't finished yet. For the men at the front, the start had been clean, and Bergmeister was leading Peter, Bernhard and Maassen. Mark Lieb made up a place, then lost it to Wolf Hensler, and at the next corner, Werner elbowed Lieb into a spin, which also took out Zampedri. With so much wreckage strewn around the circuit, the safety car was inevitably brought out. And here's that start line incident again. With Eichmann and Bambini locked together, there are some phenomenal avoidances as everybody else manages to steer a course through the clouds of rubber smoke and carry on racing. When the safety car pulled in again, Jörg Bergmeister set about consolidating his lead from Peter, Bernhard, Maassen, Ortelli and Hensler. Then Bernhard got past Peter for second. Werner's dented nose is evidence of his nudge on lead. And Ortelli now had his mirrors very full of Hensler, who was hungry for fifth place, trying both sides and getting very cosy down into the first chicane. And then having a little cuddle coming out. Maassen managed to get inside Peter and Lesmo. Peter hung on, but as they went wheel to wheel into the second Lesmo apex, Maassen made it stick. Very neat and a rare Super Cup overtaking manoeuvre without body damage. Ortelli decided he could do the same and follow Maassen through. But braking late for the Violoni chicane, Peter held his line and his fourth place. Bergmeister, meanwhile, had been wound in by Timo Bernhard, but Jörg just hung on to win by a fifth of a second. Behind them, Maassen led the queue for third from Peter, Ortelli and Hensler. And this victory left the Infineon driver very happy, knowing now the Super Cup title was in the bag for Bergmeister.
Well, the grid is forming up for the final race in this year's Formula 3000 Championship. That's Justin Wilson taking his front row slot. Let's find out more from Simon.
Well, the Formula 3000 Championship may be resolved, but in this final round, there are a lot of scores to settle. Wilson wants to beat Juan Pablo Montoya's all-time 3,000 points total. Here's the grid. Mark Webber down in fourth spot. Darren Manning in 12th. And 0.3 seconds cover the top 10 on the grid. So that curtailed qualifying has made things incredibly close. Let's hear now from some of the men near the front of the grid.
It's the last race. I'm just looking to do the best I can. And we see.
I've had a few rough races in the last few, so it would be nice to finish with the result at least. And you know, this is my last 3000 race, so you know, I want to finish with a nice one. So.
Starting from second, not too bad at all. You got a nice long drag up to the first chicane there. Does that help you out?
I don't know. We'll see. It's going to be quite chaotic into the first corner. It's so tight, you would not believe. So yeah, we'll see what happens. Hopefully, we can come out the other side in good shape.
And looking at that rear wing, it looks like pretty low downforce compared to some of the other cars on here that you've gone for.
Yeah, we're all running similar kind of downforce. It's just different configurations, whether or not it's the two elements or the three elements. So, yeah, I think we'll find out in the race what's the best combination.
There's our pole position man, the young Brazilian rookie, Antonio Pizzonia, already a winner in Formula 3000, of course, won at Hockenheim back in July. And Giorgio Pantano, also a rookie, but one who's yet to score a win. Very important for him here in his home race at Monza. Mark Webber insinuating himself into the Lola's cockpit. And there's that long drag down to the first corner with a very tight chicane that they all funnel down into. And they're getting ready now for the formation lap, and I can see yellow flags waving. Somebody has stalled. I think, in fact, a couple of cars have stalled. The yellow flags say that the driver can't get moving on the formation lap, and if they do get started, it's three cars, in fact, stranded. Mario Hammerfeld is one of them. There's Bas Meinders, the Belgian, getting a push, and it's Joel Kamathias at the back of the grid who is the third car. Hammerfeld's car has been started, Kamathias coming up through, but they're pushing Leinders away from the grid into the pit lane to see if they can sort the trouble out. If those three can get going, and two of them have done, they will have to start from the back of the grid. So Pizzonia and Justin Wilson leading the field round on the completion of their formation lap, coming into position now, a gap where Mario Hammerfeld and Bas Leinders should be. Bas Leinders, in fact, is in the pit lane along with Antonio Garcia, but we've got more yellow flags on the grid. Several more cars seem to have stalled. They're going to have to abort the start, I think, while they sort it out. Let's take a break. Welcome back to Monza with the cars coming round on another formation lap. And let's look at what happened when they started this formation lap. Two more cars failed to get away. Mark Webber was one, Gabriele Lancieri the other. And it seems that the unusual proximity of qualifying and the race has exposed some unforeseen glitches in these Formula 3000 cars electrics. But this is now the start once more. The red lights are on and they're off. And Pizzonia makes a good start from pole with Pantano following him through, and he moves across on Pantano, just elbows him onto the grass. Pantano kisses the barriers but is back in the race, and it's Pizzonia leading Wilson with David Salins in third place as they come down to the first chicane. And a big collision, that was Toccacello coming down the inside, just driving into Freisacker and into Darren Manning, the red car stationary there. Several cars stranded. Off goes Mark Webber now, hit by Fontana, and Gohan is off the road. A quite extraordinary start to what has already turned into an extraordinary Formula 3000 race. Out comes the safety car, no surprise at all, as Pizzonia and Wilson and David Salins and Sperafico lead the field round. There's Darren Manning walking away with Patrick Freisacker. I don't think they can either of them understand what on earth Toccacello was doing. And that's what he did do, straight into the side of Patrick Freisacker, who is forced into Darren Manning, and then up in the air goes Toccacello. All three of them out of the race, and Mark Webber and Fontana and Gonin out as well. There's the safety car taking the field around while we wait for the race to restart.
Got a good start, went down the outside of a couple. Me and Patrick, we'd given each other room on the first corner, and then all of a sudden, bang, into the side of Patrick. And I was just the passenger on the outside. It's a shame, really, because I probably would have been third and fourth.
Poor Darren Manning, what a dreadful Formula 3000 season he's had. But the safety car pulls off now, and look at Justin Wilson going storming up behind Pizzonia. Really gets the run on him as they come away from the restart. Have their wheel to wheel, and Justin Wilson's got him. Justin Wilson leads down into the first chicane. Somebody's locked up and he's going off. Was that David Salins? It was. David Salins goes straight on. But it's Wilson from Pizzonia, from Pantano. Despite that delay, Sperafico is fourth. David Salins a recovering fifth. Amazingly, Derek Hill, who was 23rd on the grid of this extraordinary race, is up to sixth place ahead of Maurizio and Viktor Maslov, the Russian. They're all jockeying for position through into the second chicane. But the real battle is on for second place, because Pizzonia is second, but Pantano, who was elbowed out of the way by Pizzonia as they came away from the start, seems to be absolutely furious, and he's really pushing him very, very hard indeed. Justin Wilson, the leader. The green and yellow car in second place is Pizzonia. The all-yellow car in third is Cantano, as they all go streaming around the long, long Parabolica corner. Meanwhile, Mario Haberfeld getting a run down the inside of Victor Maslov, goes ahead of him as they go down to the first chicane. And now look at a mistake there from Pizzonia, who's locked up. Cantano goes one side, then the other, tries to get alongside, can't. Pizzonia has hung onto the place. And that's Derek Hill spinning off, and Piccini also. The two of them waltzing off the road at the first chicane before Derek Hill goes across the grass and rejoins once more. Justin Wilson, still the leader. And Pizzonia just hanging on to that second place because Pantano nearly got him again at the second chicane. Good and white. Plumes of rubber smoke as everybody locks up their brakes going into these tight Monza chicanes. And that's Bas Leinders going past Victor Maslov for eighth place. Bas Leinders, who started from the pit lane and has come storming up through the field, but it's still Justin Wilson in the lead. Pizzonia just hanging on from Pantano. Ricardo Sferofico and David Salins fourth and fifth. Then it's Ricardo Maurizio ahead of Haberfeld, Leinders, Maslov, Goossens. Lancieri is in 11th spot. And at the front, Justin Wilson has a little bit of daylight ahead of the battling Pizzonia and Pantano. Fourth is Pizzonia's teammate. That's Ricardo Sferofico. Then David Salins. And a real battle going on for sixth between Maurizio and Haberfeld. You can see Haberfeld diving out of the slipstream, but then tucking back in again as they go around that long, long Parabolica corner. Gabriele Lancieri having a look down the inside of Goossens, but decides to get back inside the slipstream. And once more, look at this battle for second place coming down into the chicane. Pantano thought about it. Pizzonia locked up his wheels once more. And Mario Haberfeld has gone ahead of Maurizio. Once more, Lancieri alongside Goossens goes all the way around the outside of the chicane, chops down on the inside. The Durango team cheering him on. And Pizzonia really pushing Justin Wilson now. Justin Wilson going a little bit wide, coming out of the chicane. And Pizzonia is there. Pizzonia goes past Justin Wilson to lead. Once more, locks up a front wheel going into Lesmo, but he's held it together. And now Justin Wilson under threat from Pantano as well. Wilson got the second chicane wrong, going in under braking. It just lost him a little bit of pace. And that was all Antonio Pizzonia wanted. The Brazilian now leads. The Englishman is second. The Italian in third place. A little shot there of Derek Moore watching his boy, looking a little bit worried. And now Justin Wilson's lost second place as well because Pantano's gone through. Wilson trying to get the place back. He's darting one side, then the other, but Pantano keeps the door shut as they go off up into Lesmo. And this is Victor Maslov going like a train and going off the track like a train. The Russian having perhaps his greatest moment of glory in Formula 3000, but getting back onto the circuit. And Mario Haberfeld now alongside David Salins down the inside. He's gone on the brakes very late. He's locked up his brakes. He's going to go off. And he takes David Salins with them. And they too weave through those polystyrene blocks and get back onto the circuit. That was Haberfeld being just a little bit anxious down the inside. And that's allowed Bas Leinders to catch them up. Leinders goes past Salins for sixth. And he's winding in Haberfeld. It's going to be fifth place any moment. And we're hearing now that Antonio Pizzonia has been given a stop-go penalty. We don't know why yet. I think something to do with the start. As Leinders does go by Haberfeld into fifth place, a tremendous drive. Yeah, they're getting the news at the Astrobega pit that Pizzonia is going to have to serve a stop-go penalty, and it's for that moment, which we see in replay, when Pizzonia just pushed Pantano off the grid, and here comes Pantano, and for the first time in his Formula 3000 career, he is going to lead a Formula 3000 race because the man in front of him, Pizzonia, there is his pit crew, is going to have to come in and serve a 10-second stop-go penalty. And Pizzonia now dives into the pits. He's going very quickly. He's going to have to slow down as he does over the white line to make sure he hits the speed limit in the pits. And there is Pantano, our new leader. Justin Wilson in the red car behind him is in second place. And there is Pizzonia stationary in the pits while his mechanic counts off those 10 precious seconds on the watch and then will motion him out again, does so. And a furious Pizzonia goes out with spinning wheels. We look at our leaders. There is Pantano in the lead. There is Justin Wilson in second place. On his tail, it's Ricardo Sferofico in the other green and yellow Petrobras car, who is third. His teammate Pizzonia seems to have pretty much given up, as we see Riccardo Maurizio being closed on by Gabriele Lancieri, and Lancieri up in the air! Tremendous impact on the back of Maurizio's car. Lancieri comes to a halt backwards, and there is Maurizio, and miraculously the back of his car still seems to be intact, and he's racing on. We see it again. He just hit the rear wheel of Maurizio's car, did Lancieri, his car rearing up in the air. And there is Pizzonia, throws his crash helmet down. He's decided he's had enough motor racing for the day, started on pole position, but threw it away with that aggressive move on Pantano. Well, there is Pantano now in a comfortable lead, several lengths ahead of Justin Wilson, who's way back in his mirrors, Sferafico in third place, and the dark red car you saw in the distance is fourth. That is the brilliant Baz Leinders. Remy started from the pit lane and he stormed up through, but the checkered flag is waiting and Giorgio Pantano wins at home, almost runs over the man with the flag. Delight in his pit. Giorgio Pantano takes his first win in Formula 3000. And what an extraordinary race it's been. Those aborted starts, a string of accidents in the first corner, that slap on the wrists for Pulman Pizzonia, and Pantano has ended his first 3000 season in the way he'd like to start his second. As for Justin Wilson, he's ended his Formula 3000 career with his 10th podium finish.
First class for Pantano. Mario Haberfeld was later penalised for that incident with Salens. He drops to 13th. But Justin Wilson right in among the celebrations again.
It's been a fantastic year and, yeah, everything's just been great.
Operation.